They're using their voice not in a way to benefit the institution. They're blowing up the institution.
Why should they benefit the institution that
because
treated
that's
them
the
so badly?
I don't think they did get treated badly. I think it's an absolute nonsense. Sorry.
Tonight, we'll be talking about the new 6-part Netflix documentary series from Prince Harry and Meghan Markle that comes out this week. The series, which examines the couple's tumultuous exit from the royal family, is already raising questions about racism and belonging in Britain's oldest institution, as well as the very nature of royalty itself. So what should we expect from this documentary? And why is it being released now? Just 3 months after the death of Queen Elizabeth and with the new King Charles not yet coronated, are we about to witness a couple in vain pursuit of celebrity or a shocking expose that will bring the future of the monarchy into serious question? Joining me at the table to get to the bottom of exactly that are journalist and author Yasmin Alibhai-Brown, author of This Is Why I Resist, Dr. Shola Mos-Shogbamimu, royal commentator Josh Rom, and talk TV host James Max. So let's go straight to it. The trailer has dropped. The series is ready to launch. What do we all think? Josh, I'm going to go to you. You are a bit of a royalist, I believe.
Yes, you could say that, yeah. My first thoughts of the trailer were that it's going to be full of bombshells. There's no question about it. Meghan saying that the stakes are so high, wouldn't it be, isn't it better to hear the story from us? We've seen in the full trailer Harry accusing the royal family already of planting stories in the British press in a systematic campaign against them. So I'm expecting this series to be full of bombshell after bombshell after bombshell, to a higher degree and to going into more detail than could be achieved in the Oprah interview.
You're not happy that it's being released at all?
Listen, I have absolutely no problem with them going to do whatever they want to do. And I've always said this, that I've had no problem them telling their story, all of that stuff, but get rid of the titles, relinquish the titles. I don't think it's fair that they continue to profit off links and go around going to this event, that event, that event, being introduced as the Duke and Duchess of Sussex when they continue to slam the monarchy again and again and again. I say, if you want to go and do a documentary, you are more than entitled to do that. I am all for freedom of speech, freedom of expression, absolutely. That's what I've always been about. But relinquish the titles, get rid of the links.
Josh.
Shola.
Get over yourself. Relinquish what title? Fine. Okay,
not hold on.
Hold up a second. Okay, fine. Duke and Duchess of Sussex. Wait, Duke and Duchess of Sussex to one side. Fine. Then Prince and Princess. Because as far as he is the son of Prince Charles, just like Prince William is, he can introduce himself as Prince Harry. She will automatically, of course, be Princess Meghan.
That's not true. That's not true.
He is Prince Harry.
He's Prince Harry, and that's by birthright.
This conversation is not about the only reason I'm drawing it to your attention. It's because that is nonsense. It's irrelevant.
No, but
you can't say that you're in support of their freedom of speech and then be upset that they are speaking using the very titles that they have and the names that they have. It's not hypocritical.
I think it is.
They can tell their story. They should come out and tell the world their truth. But you can't do it while you're Duke and Duchess of Sussex. Well, okay, they're doing it as prince.
No, Shola.
As members of the royal family. No, I let you finish so you will listen to me. I agree with you about the bombshells. I do think that what we're probably going to see is an extended response to the backlash that they've received since the Oprah interview. Because what I've seen with Harry and Meghan is this. The Oprah interview came out in response to the backlash from 2 years previously, right? When they decided to step down. This, to me, is going to be in response to
they
the backlash
stepped down,
since...
They've stepped back. Difference.
Okay, whatever. Whether they step back, step down.
Their titles are inactive. They are not relinquished. They are not non-existent.
With all due respect, that is a non-issue. It's a non-issue.
That's what a lot of the criticism goes.
It is.
Are we going to be allowed to speak?
Yes. And please,
are we coming into this conversation?
Thinking about you at home, we know how irritating it is when people talk over each other, right? So let's not do that, panel.
But Josh and I were having a party.
We are having a party.
Yes, what would you like to say?
Well, I think they'll find, as Josh has just done, and don't interrupt me.
I'm not going to.
Find a different reason every time. Even in the introduction, it says 3 months after the Queen died. She's dead. She can't watch.
Thank you.
Okay? 6 months after the Queen died. 7.5 months after the Queen died. Prince Charles has just become... There's always something that they will hold against them. Mm-hmm. And I think... There are so many things to say about this, but one of the things that has most disturbed this family and the nation up to a point is that not only did the son of Diana marry a woman who was not white and an aristocrat, but also that these two have an equal relationship. Mm. And that equal relationship blows their minds. Mm, 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 mm. They can't bear it.
Can I just put a couple of things out there?
I hope so.
The thing is that, first of all, I think the Queen issue having died is, I agree, a non-issue. And I also think the titles thing is less important than what they're actually doing, which is profiting off the fact that the reason that we know who they are, certainly that we know who she is, of course she was in suits and all that sort of stuff, but it's because they were part of this incredible institution and they became world famous as a result of it. What I'm concerned about is not that they're telling their side, and also I am sure that there are aspects to that life which are horrific. I would not wish to be a member of that royal family if you paid me all the tea in China.
Yeah.
What they're doing, though, is that they are profiting, taking huge amounts of money from Netflix to make this, and they know, no head in hands, they know that, for example, the Netflix little snippets that have dropped already been beautifully made, but why start to introduce the lies already? Why use footage of a photographer's bank, which was there for a Harry Potter movie to show that, oh, our lives are so terrible because we get followed wherever we go by the paparazzi? Just tell the story, because we know that with the Oprah interview that there were... It wasn't lies, it was kind of half-truths and bits and pieces. It's, like, far more credible to tell your story without the lies. Don't do it. It's
James,
so disappointing.
What is disappointing is you're deflecting. Everything you've just said now has absolutely jack-all to do with why they're doing what they're doing.
They're taking money.
You're saying they're taking money. And it's because it is because...
They're earning money, I think.
You say they're taking money.
They're earning
it. And they're profiting because of their position. Well, all of the hate and the death threats and the lack of security, all of these experiences was because of their position. So you can't say that when they have borne the brunt of some, you know, of abuse, of harassment, they cannot then use that same position to defend themselves. You're deflecting, you're distracting. Focus on the issue. The only reason Harry and Meghan can come out to say ABC happened is because of what was done to them. If the royal family and this lovely country of ours had handled and treated them better, none of this conversation would be happening.
But I think there's an element where, of course, they have been treated very badly as a result of the position that they are in. That if you have a constitutional monarchy, guess what? Some people don't like it. Some people don't like the fact that they're born into privilege. Some people don't like the decisions that the royal family take, or the way that the things are, people are treated within it, or the fact that you're just born into this position and it just happens. But on the other hand, if you are going to make and take money, which they are, out of a system as a result of basically throwing and lobbing bombs in, then I think that you've got to be accountable for that.
You're deflecting and distracting.
I will go straight in.
Hold on. The point of this table discussion today is the fact that Harry and Meghan are doing this documentary to tell their story. Their side of the story, right? And of course they're going to get paid for it. Why shouldn't they get paid for it? Lots of members of the royal family get paid for a lot of things. Ooh, I think somebody received a bag of cash recently.
That was a charity.
Of course it was a charity.
It was for a charity.
All due respect, everything that went around that with Prince Charles, and I don't want us to deflect or be distracted by that. The point is,
members of... But you're making a point, so we'll be distracted.
Members of the royal family all of them, from those who are senior to those
Prince
who are
Andrew
young,
for
all
starters.
Of them benefit from
Prince
being
Andrew?
Members of the royal family.
Yeah, of course
never.
They do. Listen,
no,
we'll all be in agreement on Andrew.
But we're not talking about Andrew here. Andrew is
talk
not
about,
the problem.
I will talk about Andrew because Andrew, I'm not talking about his latest scandal. Throughout his years, he has received money from all kinds of dodgy leaders.
Agreed.
Okay, so Agreed. We've never
First time
had...
Ever. Yeah.
Tell me, have you ever had a crisis over that, like you're having over
no.
these two?
And even the Queen's
yes.
grandchildren...
When?
And what's it called, the cousins...
I think the most recent crisis with Prince Andrew,
Josh, I think, is a big crisis,
to be honest. That has shaken the monarchy to its core.
The point is, every member of the royal family, every produce from the Queen's loins have all benefited, those we know, we don't know of, have all benefited financially from being related to the Queen. So saying that Harry and Meghan, who have bigger exposure, bigger stage, should not get paid for using their voice and time, that's nonsense.
No. But what they're doing is they're using their voice not in a way to benefit the institution. They're blowing up the institution.
Why should they benefit the institution
that
because
treated
that's
them
the
inter- so badly?
I don't think they did get treated badly. I think it's an absolute nonsense.
Sorry. His mother, Harry's mother, was treated appallingly
yes,
by that
was.
Institution. Meghan was treated appallingly by
yes,
that institution.
Yes.
Actually, Princess Margaret, before she became a drunk, was appallingly treated by the institution. Do not tell me. And, you know, I can't bear Prince Charles, but a part of me also thinks that if only they had allowed them, him, to marry Camilla, Diana wouldn't have died. Do not talk to me about this institution.
I agree with
that. It's a rotten institution.
So do you think that the institution should just go?
Yes.
Because, right, now you see, I think that's quite important.
You're deflecting.
No, because if...
The point is you're trying to accuse Harry and Meghan of profiting when all they're doing is earning.
Are you saying they're earning? I'm sorry. They are...
Stop a second. We've got a difference of opinion here in terms of, are they just pure opportunists looking to make a buck, which you don't think is deserved, and using the family's name in the wrong way? Or are they actually using this as an opportunity? There's been so many, much injustice. Yasmin, you just listed out all of the women who have suffered as a result.
Yeah.
Or are they just using this as an opportunity to shed light on what is, frankly, a misogynistic, racist, potentially, institution?
Backward institution.
I think there are lots of things about the royal family and the institution that I'm sure everybody would wish to change. I think to call it misogynistic when you've had the Queen
that.
Who has been in charge of it for 70 years. Well, I think it's probably because I'm right.
Let me set you free. Let me set you free right now, because when the Queen passed away, and I heard people go, oh, the Queen is a feminist icon. Icon to whom? There is no any woman out there that'll go, oh, one day I will be Queen Elizabeth. That's never going to happen. A lot of there are women who disrupted.
None of us around this table are going to be members of the royal family.
There are women who did far more than Queen Elizabeth ever did in her entire reign, who broke down barriers for women and young girls so that they could be what they could see.
Are you saying that she didn't achieve?
No, she did not achieve anything as a feminist icon, which you're trying to say, oh, because
really?
She was the head of state. Nonsense.
She inherited the position.
She inherited the position and did jack all with it. There were women fighting for women's rights. Ooh. The Queen did not do that, did she?
Really?
We're digressing.
Yes. Just very quickly, I haven't actually said anything for the past couple of minutes. I've been very good.
I just wanted to hear, actually, this is about Harry and Meghan.
But very quickly about Her Majesty the Queen. She actually changed the line of succession. So,
yes,
women in the future could have equal rights in the line of
succession. The reason she did that is because other women fought for the rights of women to be equal, and she benefited off that. To be able to push for
no,
a...
No, she didn't.
Yes, she did.
She
did not set...
What a lot of dribble.
Listen to me.
No matter how much we
listen. Do you know how the line of succession works?
Listen to me.
Do you know how the line of succession works?
The Queen did not set the pace. Other women set the pace on women's rights.
You're right.
To the point that the royals now went... Or actually, I think it now makes sense that we should change the line of succession so that Anne and other women are not, you know... put aside by their brothers. Other women set the pace, not the Queen of...
Elizabeth. The Queen did.
Well, she did not set the pace, other women
did. Can we talk about Meghan?
But let's talk about Meghan. Let's talk about Harry and Meghan. Because whilst, in my view, William and Kate are grafters, Harry and Meghan are grifters. Let's just be clear about that. The way they are behaving is so appalling, and the things that they are doing and the way that they are being manipulated in order to create something. Will I watch the Netflix thing? Absolutely I will. It's going to be bombshell. I'm going to love it. All the delicious... But I'm like watching The Crown. What's real? What's not so real? What's based on, what's in somebody's head as opposed to reality? If you are in an institution, in the same way that we all work for companies, we work for them, there are lots of things that go on in life that perhaps are difficult to deal with, that people didn't do the right thing, they didn't respect each other and they didn't work in the right way. There are a lot of things that are not done right. And I'm not going to try and pretend that the royal institution is perfect. Of course it's not. There are plenty of things about it which are old-fashioned.
Rotten, I would say. Rotten.
You say rotten. There are elements of it which are rotten, and I agree with you.
Absolutely rotten.
But,
and for this woman who came from a very different world, and I remember writing 3,000 words, the cover story in Times... US, Time Magazine US. And at the end, I said, she doesn't know the country she's entering. She doesn't know the family she's entering. The only way they were, this was 5 months before they got married, the only way they will survive is if they leave. She had no idea about the backstory in this family. Mm. And you talk to me about racism. Over and over again. Charles says to a woman I know, a journalist I know, from Manchester. They meet in Manchester. Anita, what's her surname? I've forgotten. He says, where are you from? She says, Manchester. You don't look as if you're from Manchester. The Prince Philip, I met him at the Royal Shakespeare Company because I was a governor. I'm standing with my husband. He passes us by. He comes back and he looks at my husband and he says, you're... married to her? No. Is she yours? Mm. They are full of it. Mm. And Meghan had to survive it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I haven't met the royal family in the same way that you have. I think that there are a lot of attitudes in our society which over time, thankfully, have changed, and there are a lot more that still need to change. And there are a lot of discussions that we can have about sexism and racism and homophobia and anti-Semitism and all these things which exist in our society, and let's hope that they all get eradicated. The point here, though, is that not that I don't want to see Harry and Meghan go off and do great things. I think that they could have done great things within the institution, and I'm sad that they didn't, and I think that there's an element that pushed them out. I agree with that. But what I really find distasteful is that they're not seeking their path through telling future stories and trying to perhaps create a new role for themselves. They are simply profiting from exposing the stuff that they want to say and to make themselves look
better.
Meghan
has just been given an award for her work.
Mm. Yeah, shambolic.
What do you mean, shambolic?
Shambolic load of old nonsense.
So when she does work...
Clarify what the award is, please.
The award was, I think, for her work for women, dispossessed women. They are being honoured in America for work that is not connected to this rotten family. So don't say that's all they do. They sit around obsessing about...
You're talking about the one
for exposing racism in the royal family and the la la la. I'm sorry, that's a nonsense.
No, it's not a nonsense because it takes courage to do that within an institution. I do find, James, that you are a walking contradiction. You just said now you reflected on how terrible you find certain things can be in this institution. And of course, you know, ABC and blah, blah, blah. But at the same time, you go, but how they then... they speak out against what they've experienced within the same institution. You've highlighted what is wrong in the institution. That is what they experience. They're now speaking about what they experience. And you have an issue about
tens
it.
Tens of millions of dollars.
They're earning it.
Why shouldn't they? Well,
they're earning it.
Yeah,
because they're not taking our money.
How is that your problem?
How are they earning
That's
it?
Their
the same way you are earning
they're doing
being
something
here.
And they're being paid for
it.
And I'm sharing my story here.
And your opinion.
And my opinion.
And they're sharing this
they
story and opinion.
Every right to do
but they've
so,
got
but
far more value
they,
than you.
So they're earning more than you.
Sorry about that. So sorry. They're earning more than you.
I do have a problem with this. Because they are earning it. As much as you might not like it, they are earning it.
No, I have no problem with them earning money.
It's not taxpayers' money. It's not been handed to them.
And again, but then... leave the entire thing behind them. Why have the titles? Why continue to be? It is theirs. Shola, they're continuing going to events left, right, and centre, being introduced as the Duke and Duchess.
Because they are.
And they are earning their money by continuously slamming the institution.
No, they're earning their money by the value they bring.
They're not telling new stories.
They're not telling
new stories.
They're
not telling new stories.
Please. They're not telling new stories. We're jamming. Shola.
We're jamming. Okay. I thought that was going to be a slow, tepid intro before we head into the real nitty-gritty stuff, which we're about to do now.
Look at all of us on the table as if it was going to be slow.
So, yeah, maybe grab yourself a drink.
Cheers to that.
Right, so we've had a bit of palace outrage this week. So we've had Lady Hussey and a huge scandal because of the way she treated a person, a visitor, to the palace. Now, is this proof that there is a problem with racism within the royal family?
Can I go first, please?
Save us all.
Can I please go first? Thank you very much.
And then we'll allow everybody else to speak after. So you set the scene, Shola. We'll promise to be quiet until you set it. Right, I'm sitting back.
If I may say, ma'am, yes, I believe it does. It establishes the truth. It validates what Meghan Markle said. And our dear friend Yasmin here is also just giving her experiences, which, again, buttresses the point that racism has been so casually normalized within the royal institution. There are people out there thinking that what she did was perfectly okay. I mean, I've heard everything from, oh, you must leave Lady Susan Hussey alone because she may be deaf, have dementia.
83, she was 83, mad. 83, 83.
She's married to a man with one leg, or I don't know, she's 83. All kinds of, I'm thinking, but what has that got to do with her behavior? Her actions.
You did make a really interesting point, actually, which was because a lot of people were saying she didn't realise what she was doing.
Oh, she did.
And you said there doesn't have to be intent for racism.
Absolutely, absolutely.
It's actually in our law. But I think, indirect discrimination.
Yeah, but I think there are a couple of things to pick up from that, and I'm certainly not going to excuse the way that she approached it because I think it's wrong.
They say she's naive.
No, she's not naive. I actually think she was being more snobbish and hoity-toity, if you like.
That's also part of racism.
Yes, it is, I agree. And in order to understand how to approach, for example, it is, I think, perfectly reasonable to ask somebody about their heritage. I'm quite often asked about my heritage. Oh, you have an unusual surname. Why is that? Oh, well, because, you know, a couple of generations ago...
18 questions?
Yeah, but I agree. So I disagree.
Do they push your hair to the side as they...
No, listen, that's wrong. I think the way she asked the questions was wrong. I also think that there's a bit of me that wonders, and I don't know the answer to this, there's a bit of me that wonders whether Ngozi was almost sparring for a fight. Because
blame the victim.
How could she have known going to that event, standing where she was standing, that a lady, Lady Susan Hussey, will make a beeline for her to ask her a question, where are you from, where she goes, oh, Hackney. Because sometimes, you know, you do that.
But she didn't let me finish.
No, she did go Hackney first. She did go Hackney first.
She went sister space.
That's fine.
Yeah,
sister
that's fine.
Space, then Hackney. Then she said, then she was asked, no, where are you from? Where in Africa? Where in Africa are you from? Or I don't know.
But how
no
do we
records.
Have a transcript?
Well, it's not a... Excuse me. Okay, you see, that is one of the most ignorant questions.
Why?
You know,
how do we have a transcript? No, why?
A transcript. Let me tell you what a transcript is. A transcript, like when you go to the police and if you've been attacked or something, and they sit down and they take your statement.
Yes, because.
Let me finish.
It's recorded.
It's not recorded. It's because you are saying, this is what she said to me. This is what I said. This is what she said to me. It's called a witness sharing their experiencing right now. And there were other witnesses that corroborated what happened.
When somebody is taken into a police station and they give a police statement, it is entirely recorded via tape recorder.
But it's their words. It is their words that are their words that are testimony. That's what's written down.
But what James is asking
is... No, that's not what James says. That's what you're saying.
No. What James is asking is...
James is here.
How is there a full transcript exactly
That's what she remembered
word
of what happened.
Yes, but that doesn't mean...
There were two other people there.
Can I just go back to
Yasmin just said, she gave an example with Prince Philip. And when she gave word for word what he said, are you now going to say she had a device on her? Do you know how silly that sounds?
Yeah, but people this is quite, to be fair, this is a detailed conversation.
Yes, yes, and it was detailed abuse, harassment, and racism. And for a lot of us, people that don't look white, we actually, it stays here. Because your spirit, you're going, what the hell was that?
Dr. Shola, yes. I am white and I can recite arguments that I've had with my husband years ago, to the day, to the month.
Isn't it interesting that you find it so unbearable to accept what happened there, that you're finding all these ridiculous... Can I finish my sentence?
No,
I would
because
like
you're
to...
Because you're
sorry,
us.
No. I'm saying, I will say
her.
What I'll say.
I don't
okay?
Her.
And then you can answer, thanks. Max. Do not bulldoze over me, please. Please, James. Don't bulldoze me, please. Don't. I will finish what I want to say. That you're both finding any excuse you can to disengage with what happened there. And what happened there was a real illustration of how backward and enclosed and completely cut off this family and her friends. I mean, the first, you know, long before this happened, when I saw Camilla had selected six women to be not her ladies in waiting or whatever they were. And I remember saying to my husband, does she not get the optics? These women are all white. Did she not think, just for the sake of pretense and PR, that she could have selected one who wasn't? She might have been better at educating Camilla herself, and this might not have happened.
But I think you're slightly projecting, because I'm agreeing with most of what you've said about not only what happened, which is appalling, not only how it was phrased, which is terrible, not only the optics, which are...
Why can't you just say racist?
Yeah, no.
Appalling, terrible. It was racist. Snobbish. It was racist. All of the adjectives you want to use, it was racist. Just call it what it is.
But I think you have to pick apart, because otherwise we're not going to get anywhere.
You're not picking apart. You're causing more problems. That's a problem with our
country. Right, OK. Can I please pick it apart?
Okay.
And I speak from somebody as well who is a person from a minority background. I myself am Jewish. And this week, I mean, this is a completely different subject. We're not going to go into it. But this week, Kanye West, to his followers, has said, I like Hitler. Yeah. So we, and James himself is Jewish, we know discrimination. Our people had their property confiscated, their shops looted, their places of worship burned to the ground. They were imprisoned and murdered in their millions just because they were Jewish. So we know discrimination. But what we're trying to do as journalists, because that is our job, is get to the bottom of all the facts. Now, we know as well, by her own admission, Ngozi was dressed in authentic African attire. Is that correct?
I'm sorry, do I look like...
No, this is for the table. This is the table.
Correct?
No, because we're picking apart the packs, the facts.
What has that got to do with anything?
No,
Let me finish my point. And this is just a question to the table, very quickly, yes or no. Was she wearing, by her own admission, authentic African attire?
I don't even know if it was by her own admission or not. I know she was dressed in
okay,
an attire.
In authentic yes. African attire, yes. And did she or did she not, in that conversation, say she was of African heritage and Caribbean descent and her parents
that was later
from the Windrush generation?
That was later down because she had been questioned over and over again after she said, I was born here, I'm British.
What I think James
I
is trying to say...
I am born here, I'm British should have been the end of where are you from?
Yes.
But she kept on here, but where are you really from? She heard... This is the...
Shola, can I please finish my point?
This is the next question she
can
got.
I finish my point?
I am born
can
here, I'm British. It was, when did you first get here? After I just told you I'm born here, I'm British, why would you
but
ask when
I,
did you first
I
get
know,
here?
I know, but can I finish my point?
I want
what
to know
I
what
think,
point you can possibly what,
and
bring
what
up
I think,
I said that.
And this is not making an excuse for Lady Susan
Sounds
Hussey.
Like it, though.
No, because I think her language, like James says, I'm not going to sit here and condone her language. I think her language was utterly despicable in the way in which it was phrased.
It
however, people ask,
me all the time,
yeah.
where are your people from? And even though, yes, I was born here in Britain, my parents were born in Britain, my grandparents were also born in Britain, my great-grandparents were born in Poland, in Russia.
And why did they ask you where your people are from?
Because they're genuinely interested.
No, no, no. Why would they ask you where your people from?
Because what led they're to the interested. Because they're
no,
interested.
No, I'm not saying the people are not interested.
No, you're asking why?
Yeah.
I'm telling you why. It's because people are actually interested.
Yeah, I have that.
What I have to say as a minority.
But if you wear an outfit.
Hussy woman, excuse me, the most posh events now, the invitation card says black tie, formal or traditional. That is what every invitation says. Yes, are you telling me that there was something wrong with how she was dressed?
No, not at all. But at the same time, I would, as a fashion expert, or not expert, but as a fashion and entertainment journalist,
wow.
The first thing that I would ask is, who are you wearing? Where did you get the outfit from?
Why did she ask that? Because, you see, I take exception to how racists, and I'm talking here just generally about how racists have used the whole language about her African attire. And I know that comes from ignorance. Because when people see somebody wearing, I don't know, something made by a French brand, nobody automatically assumes, oh, you're French, or something.
No, but I would ask, nobody automatically says,
you ask, where is it from? But what happened in this conversation was it wasn't about the attire. It was about her. And it was about Lady Huss's racial bias of this lady she just met.
And you're right. So, if we're going to learn from this experience, because we all, I think, in our own different ways, see that the conversation was wrong, it was inflammatory, it was racist, it was lots of things, OK? But if we are to learn, we do need to be able to have conversation. I'm fascinated by where people come from because I arrived in this country as a result of whether a default of history or horrific things going on elsewhere, and here we are. And I've also faced a whole range of things during my life, whether it be, prejudice or,
discrimination,
anti-Semitism, the whole lot.
Yeah.
So, and also people like to think that, you know, because of the way that you speak, they can make assumptions about where you come from, or you must be very posh, all of that stuff. But how do you have good and sensible, productive conversations about people's heritage without being offensive, rude, or indeed racist?
By not one, by not doubting them when they've answered your question. Two, by actually asking the question you want to ask, which is whether it's the heritage or, oh, I like what you're wearing, where is it from? Or where are your earrings from? I mean, I have people who ask me, sometimes they ask me either where are you from, either because of my accent or because of my name. And it depends on where I am. Whenever I'm out of the country, I know they're asking me where I come from, i.e. what nationality are you? I answer that. Whenever I'm in the country and I'm asked that question, I'm either thinking where I live. I don't automatically think you're asking me where do you order because I'm British.
I'm sorry, I want to make...
was also asked about her nationality and where she came from.
All she was asked was, where are you from?
No,
yes, listen.
Susan Hussey said no, where are you from? What nationality are you?
No, she said, where in Africa are you from?
Yes, and then afterwards, she said, hey, UK, and Lady Susan Hussey said no, but what nationality are you?
She should have answered that question.
Can I come in? If she was an immigration officer, she had the right to ask that. Nobody has the right to ask that question.
Over
what nationality
and over
are you?
And over
absolutely
again.
Not. After and you, having movingly described that some of the experiences you both have, should have more sympathy and understand why there is a point after which you know the code and you know what's happening. All right, so that's point number one. But let me tell you two other stories.
Ask, where are my people from? That's the thing. When people ask about my heritage, I don't have a problem with that because I have Jewish
heritage. We do.
I know, but that's what James and I are saying. We do not deny that the language was bad, but what we're saying is there was different intentions.
Marina, can I just challenge Josh on this question?
We are not going to get through any of our questions.
But Josh said he and James understand because you're also from a minority group. And I want to ask you this, that when you experience an anti-Semitic event,
yes,
and then you have to talk about it,
yes,
and you share what happened,
yes,
How would you feel if somebody said, did you have a device on you, when you're sharing exactly your acute, you know, memory of what has happened?
I think as a journalist, people have every right to question that.
Why?
Because people have a right to get to the bottom of the facts and conduct thorough investigations.
So, when they ask that and you say to them, I was there, I'm the witness, it happened to me. But then you keep trying to use that, because that's what you've just done. You've tried to use that against Ngozi to try to discredit.
You've manipulated the conversation.
Right. Can I just tell you these two stories? Because the racism in the royal family goes a long way back. So when a film, yet another film, came out about Diana's love affair with a Pakistani surgeon.
Was that the one with Sienna Miller?
No, the one with the Australian actress, I think. It wasn't a very good movie, okay?
Naomi Watts.
Yes.
That's it, sorry. Okay. That was my mistake.
And I then talked to people who were connected, and some of them in Dodi's family, and some of the people in her Pakistani lover's family. And they told me some of the stuff that the royal family was doing because they were appalled that she had two brown lovers. And you know, there is a secret service in this country. There are all, and this is what Harry is going to be talking about, the leaking of information. But the response to Diana having those two lovers, people need to remember that history and that story. And how,
I don't think they've forgotten.
A lot of people have.
No, I don't.
So the racism we're talking about...
Diana didn't have the titles at the time. She didn't have her HRH
title. Why are you obsessed with titles?
I'm going to move on.
I'm going to move on from the question that was asked by Lady Hussey to probably a much more provocative one, which is the question around skin colour of Archie, which Meghan talked about. Is that she was asked how dark is he going to be? Now, is this racism?
So she wasn't asked. I think that was what was said to Harry. Is what she shared during the Oprah interview.
Yes.
I think there's a really interesting conversation to be had about this, because I think it slightly depends on how you phrase a question. Because I think, as far as I'm concerned, everybody I know who is of either mixed race heritage. And I know quite a lot of couples who are from different backgrounds, that a lot of people will ask questions about hair colour, about skin colour, about complexion, will they be more mum, more dad, more anything else. It actually comes down to how it was asked. Mm. Because I think to ask that question should, I hope, be quite an innocent one, in the same way that I'm sure that when you look at your friends, I'm sorry, when you look at your friends and you say, for example, one of your friends is blonde and one of them's got brown hair.
I'm never going to say to them, I wonder what colour your baby's going to be. James,
you don't say it like that.
I wouldn't even say, I wonder if he or she will come out pink, between pink or ebony, or you would never say that.
I'm not saying that.
I have three daughters. My main concern before they came out of me was, please, in the name of God, do not come out with your father's nose. I thought, I'm not asking too much. Just don't have his nose. Man is so much better. Can you see? Of course, they all came out with variation of his nose. I get it that people are, you know, family members, people get fascinated, yada, yada. But it was not a question that was posed, Harry. It was a concern. Meghan and Harry corroborated this, that a concern about the baby's color was shared with them. Concern.
Yeah, you
people.
Said the word concern.
Concern.
And the question
it's
is.
It's an English word.
Yeah.
That should raise red flags.
Now, I agree. If they use the word concern, I am too concerned. That they are concerned. If they are speculating, I think speculating over hair colour or how they're going to look or the mum or the dad or whatever.
The mums and the dads have that right. Nobody else has.
It's not about a right.
It is. No. No. Nobody else can tell me.
My
mother would never say, what colour is this baby going to be? My husband's English.
It's not about what colour, but it's about what's the baby
going to be. Can I give you something? I'm sorry. Actually, can I just say, I had this exact conversation with my friend today. So my friend is going through IVF treatment. She has a female partner and they're going through the process of IVF and they were telling me today about their sperm donor. And she was telling me how their sperm donor is going to be Greek Cypriot. And I said to her, oh my goodness, does that mean the, like you, you tan very easily as well? Will this Greek, will your baby be, will have it, will it have olive skin?
That conversation is very different from concern.
No, but we don't know.
We don't know what that conversation was.
Harry said there was a concern. Yeah, but Harry, there's a lot of things that I doubted. No one doubted exactly what that conversation was.
Please, can you heed my warning from before the show? We need to stop talking over each other.
And I was making my point until I got rudely shouted over.
Nobody's rude.
If I was your friend, I would find that question really invasive.
It's probably why you're not his friend.
And actually, she did not find it invasive because she jokes, yeah, my baby is going to have such a lovely suntan.
I'm telling you.
He or she is going to have olive skin, and I love that.
Let's go back.
She didn't find it invasive at all.
Sizzle.
Well, I think it is. Nothing to do with you, the baby.
But it wasn't a concern, it was speculation.
But if that's the case, then there's nothing to do with us that we're talking about Harry.
They used the word concern in the opera. Yeah, but
can I just say, the royal family haven't responded. They're not going to respond. And Harry and Meghan knew what they were doing there. They knew that they were using inflammatory language to create damage to the royals.
And take a breath.
The royal family responded with, recollections may vary, which means what they said was true because they know they don't want to come out and say, oh, we actually had that conversation.
Okay, right, it does not say that, but you know what, you can think what you like.
It says recollections may vary.
Yes.
Recollections may vary.
And Harry and Harry's recollections may vary from the royal family's recollections.
No, it doesn't. They finally respond.
Right. So basically what we're saying here is whether it was a concern is based on whether we believe Harry or not. He's told us it's a concern.
I think it's actually...
There you go.
Absolutely. It's a question as to whether it was a concern or whether it's a genuine question of interest. And
or
I think that they're two very different things. And I would agree with you. If it was a concern, that is not acceptable.
Which is why
and there's an element that we all talk about things. And if you say, Yasmin, that, you know, it's none of your business and you shouldn't talk about it, then there are a whole load of things that we shouldn't talk about. Why are we here?
I wonder if there are any other royal couples, Kate and William included, where anybody in the royal family expressed an interest in what the baby will come out. Like. The colour.
I think there's the hair colour and the eye colour and all of that. Definitely hair colour.
With a background of racism that Meghan had been experiencing. With all of that, and remember, Harry had come out in 2016 to complain and speak out for the first time because nobody else was in. Buckingham Palace wasn't doing, Kensington Palace wasn't doing. And he said he spoke out against racist undertones. There was not the undertone, it was racist, that his wife was experiencing in the press. So to hear that on top of everything, what was said to him, concerns, people. Okay. It's that English word.
Okay, moving on.
Yeah, but you're placing inflection.
Moving on. Let's take us back to that sizzle.
It is inflection.
It's fat.
Excuse me.
That's what he said. Sorry, Mariana.
Oh, my goodness me. I've got a toddler and they listen better than this. Right, taking us back to that sizzle of a trailer, right, for the series.
Nice.
There were some choice images included, actually. So, particularly of Kate, Princess of Wales, looking a tad menacing. Take a look, see what you think.
Why did you want to make this documentary?
No one sees what's happening behind the closed doors. I had to do everything I could to protect my family.
When the stakes are this high, doesn't it make more sense to hear our story from us?
Ooh, ooh, Give me goose pimples.
Darling. Tell them.
Right, can we at least agree it doesn't look like this is going to be an olive branch, this documentary?
No, it's absolutely not. It's brilliantly put together.
I mean, the way that they've set it up, the way that they've intimated the bombshells that we're going to see, the things that they've done, the imagery that they've used.
I see a love story.
Oh, no, I see. Ka-ching, ka-ching, give me the money. That's what I see.
Didn't see any love there.
Shame on you, James. Shame on you.
No, you know I'm right. Shame you know on you're you. Smiling. You know I'm right. Give me the money.
You didn't see the love.
You have a bigger issue with their money.
Give me the money.
Do you want? Look, and I'm a romantic as well, but I think there's two reasons they're doing this. That they could be doing this. One is make money.
Yes.
To earn money. Two is tell their story.
Yep. Tell their story.
There's a third reason that you haven't listed there.
Oh, tell us.
And that's to destroy the royal family.
Well,
that's the third reason why they want to do
this. I don't know about them wanting to destroy the royal family. I think the royal family has already destroyed themselves. If the acts that they've undertaken against these two are absolute facts, then Harry and Meghan are not in the wrong for saying this is what you've done. You cannot be outraged at the person who has experienced the hate instead of being outraged by the person who's perpetuated the hate.
So coming back to Marina's point, I think there is definitely a story for them to tell. Mm-hmm. And there is no doubt that there is going to be a lot of interest in them telling that story. What I would like us to get away from is that just because they've said it, it may be their perception, it may be their interpretation, it doesn't necessarily mean it's truth.
Well,
and
it
this
may
is
be
my
true.
Problem. It
well,
may
it
be.
It may be true.
It may be
Could
true.
Could you add that?
But there are a lot of things that they said, or certainly that Meghan said in that Oprah interview. Some of them were absolutely true. Some of them were
proven false.
Some of them indeed were proven false, and there were things which were their experience. Because we all know when you have a conversation with somebody else, they may take something different from it. They may not necessarily have phrased things in the right way. And we also know that the institution is slightly separate from the person. So sometimes what's going on in the family dynamic, that they're all born and put into this thing and there's loads of things which go on behind closed doors where you have this family that's just trying to be a family and it can't be because of the money, because of the royalty, because of the things. And then there's the institution of which there are hundreds, if not thousands of people and the media and all this stuff operating around them. So let's not think that they're just two lovers who da-da-da and all da-dums.
I hear your point about institution and family, but then you lose the context totally because ultimately the institution is run by the family. Every single time there were stories against Harry and Meghan, which were briefed by Buckingham Palace and Kensington Palace sources, that was approved, definitely with the knowledge
of those. And Harry and Meghan briefing and dropping stories. They're exactly the same thing.
I just want to go to what Josh said about proven false. Now, I recall one of those stories they claimed was proven false from the Oprah Winfrey thing was them saying about them having exchanging vows.
They said married. Yes, they said it was a marriage. That was Meghan's own words.
And I could not understand why that is false.
Because it was not a marriage. It was a blessing, but it wasn't a marriage.
Oh my God! So you accept that they did do something?
I don't doubt that they didn't do something. But it wasn't a marriage.
For them, definitely it was a marriage. So they had a blessing. And they exchanged vows.
It's not a marriage.
Can I please, remind people?
They didn't lie.
It's not a marriage. And Meghan said it was a marriage.
They didn't lie.
I'd like to remind
the
table.
She said it was a marriage and it wasn't marriage.
Josh, quiet. I'm saying something important here. Remember the history. Do not forget what they did to Diana. Mm. When Diana was breaking and, you know, in serious mental distress, but she wasn't mad because they were treating her so badly. And actually, just last week, one of Jeffson, I think, said that they leaked all this information about Diana. I remember Nicholas Soames saying on Newsnight, you know, she's crazy, because she did not let Charles own the narrative, because she wanted to tell her side of the story. Yep. And they leaked that she was mad. And they destroyed this woman's mental health.
They tried.
And they did the same, I think, to Meghan.
Yep.
So if you've ever had like a Twitter pylon, for example, or
loads
of people going at you, for example, and have you ever wanted just to have one tweet that goes out there, just goes, actually, this is the situation. This is the truth.
Yes.
Right, now imagine for a second Meghan and Harry's experience. Imagine all of those headlines. I think on one weekend they had like 36 headlines along, you know, Daily Mail Online, for example, just awful stories. Imagine that consistently, and then you've got this opportunity to go, do you know what? I can have a captive audience and I can just go, this is the truth.
Which is what I think they're doing.
Which is why I understand why they're doing what they're doing. But I think we just need to be a little...
But you want to write the script.
No, I don't want to write the script.
But you find it distasteful.
I'll tell you what I find distasteful. I don't find it distasteful that they're telling their side of the story. I do find the money that they're using distasteful. Because it is such a lot of money.
Oh, my God! So if they were paid £500, that would be OK?
Well, a lot of people have told their side of the story for a lot less.
OK, so, James, can you see right now, because I think the whole world is watching, can you see this is a you problem? Because what you say makes no sense.
Well, that's in your opinion.
You don't have a problem with them earning as long as it's little, and if they have to earn at all...
I would prefer to see them earning from doing other things. Walking away from the
institution... But it's none of your business how they earn. They're not stealing.
I agree. And they've done the deal, and well done to them. But my problem is that they are trashing an institution.
Which is rotten.
And the institutions
continue to benefit from links to.
Correct. And the other all thing is that there is all going to be no verification for their side of the story. They're going to say their side of the story. Some of it may be true. Some of it may be lies.
This is where you're wrong. So, we have had the side of the family story for years.
And still
every palace source, every leak, every single one, and every royal biographer that comes out, oh, having a good authority, all of them came from the family, from the institution. Right now, what you're getting is Harry and Meghan responding to that. So all they're doing is saying, this is true, this is not true. So you've had two sides of the story. So why are you now going,
problem that I have is that when that Oprah interview was done and they said this is true and this is not true, I'm afraid not everything they said was truth. Some of it was spin. Like,
we just debunked one of the...
Well, you didn't.
Truth. We did.
You didn't.
They
well,
did
you didn't.
Exchange
you
vows. Didn't. They exchanged vows.
They did not get married.
She said it wasn't.
They exchanged vows.
We're never going to agree on this and we know it's going to have the final answer on this. We're never going
to
know.
Try to speak up.
But what I would say, or the next question, I suppose, is... What does this say about the royal family? Now, we're playing along with this fantasy now. I'm not a royalist. I make, you know, that very clear. Yeah. You know, we're supposed to believe that these people, including Harry, you know, are chosen by this divine right of kings to be these beacons of virtue and morality. Like, what do things like this, situations like this, what does that do to that belief, that fantasy that we're all supposed to be playing along with?
I don't know who in their right mind has that kind of belief or thinking 2022. Bottom line is that the point of an institution that holds such power, they're not ceremonial, it's head of state, they're there to serve the people. I do not see the relevance or the point of the royal family, the monarchy, in 2022 when they cannot demonstrate how they are in service to the people. Honestly, James, I don't know about you lot, but if shaking hands, smiling, going to some events and feeling like, oh, I'm going to all these events, I don't know, 100 events, I can do that for myself. Well, I don't need anyone to do that for me.
James here said that Kate and William were grafters.
They are. Because here's the thing that they do. Now, you may or may not agree, but the point is we have a world today which requires coverage. The fact that we're discussing this, the fact that whenever the royal family go and do things, whether you like it or whether you don't, they will go on the headlines, they will be followed, and in fact they can do an incredible amount of good, whether it's nationally or internationally, and they do achieve that. Does it need modernising? Always. Are they always going to get it right? No. Are there things which are within that institution that need to change? I'm sure there are. When you have a look, though, say, for example, the Prince's Trust. The Prince's Trust has done incredible work over the years, and it's opened the nation's eyes to a lot of, whether it's deprivation or things that the system weren't producing for people, and it gave people real opportunity. there are more and more opportunities that I want to see the royal family do that. When, for example, you see the impact that, say, for example, an opening of a new building on staff or on a charity, and I'm a trustee of a charity that the Queen was a patron, the King will be patron. The difference it makes when they turn up and the things that they do and the things that they say do help to make a difference.
They're not held to account. There's no transparency around this institution. And there's this whole thing about them being above the people. And that, for me, is problematic.
And I agree with you that that we know, put it this way, we know a lot more about the royal family than we used to. I think that there is a huge amount of change that's required in this day and age when we have multimedia and all these other things that are going to have to change.
The thing is, you cannot reform.
Otherwise, you're just going to get rid of every institution.
The SA is moving. Well done. Let me tell you lots of stuff. They have obtained, I think, from George Osborne, exemption from paying full taxation. They got exemption from FOI, so we can never find out anything about their affairs. Their wills are secret. Three out of the four children in the Queen's family are divorced. This idea that they're this ideal family, the good, the best, exemplary citizens that we can look up to.
That was the purpose originally.
Yeah, I agree. And so there are many questions.
So what is the purpose?
But yeah. James, that's the point. How can they be there as an institution, as a family, benefiting from so many exemptions, sex discrimination laws, race discrimination laws.
Green laws.
They're exempted from all these things. They're being treated as though they're not like the rest of us. So that means that when something like what happened to Ngozi Fulani and Lady Hussey, God knows what else has been happening in the establishment, they cannot seek, staff, employees cannot seek, justice because the Queen or the King now and his household are exempt. That's just wrong.
Can I just answer the question? Because you said about transparency around the royal family. Well, actually, that's not true, because when it comes to their finances in particular, every year the finances are released. We know how much is in the sovereign grant.
No.
Yes, we do. We know this year that the sovereign grant is 25%
from the grant.
From the crown estate.
Josh, I need to intervene here.
I have not said one thing, Marina, throughout this whole thing.
I need to intervene, because what you're saying is a top headline figure that is published very publicly, and that's fine.
Yeah, and I don't think they know how it works.
They have actually, I think The Guardian reported on this, that they have actually used their powers, because they do have powers to change laws or influence laws where they can, to actually conceal their wealth.
Yes, they have done that.
So the sovereign fund, everyone knows about that. The sovereign grant.
But the sovereign grant has nothing to do with their wealth, and so there are two different sides to their wealth. And look, we all know, because it was announced, that the assets of Prince Charles, when he became King Charles, were then transferred to William as the new Prince of Wales. There are lots of things that I think are problematic about the wealth and about the transparency, but there are also lots of things which are problematic in terms of behaviours. So, for example, let's go back to Harry and Meghan, why not? So if they're going to tell us how to be green, but then they're going to fly on private jets, I find that problematic in the same way...
Charles does the same.
Yeah, in the same way...
And William just did.
Yes, of course, they all do.
And I do.
And so actually, William and Catherine flew commercial to Boston.
I don't use private jets, but I fly.
But that's different from a private jet in terms of carbon footprint. We'll just say that. It is different. Commercial airlines and private jets are completely different in terms of carbon footprint.
I love private jets and let them carry on using them. But I think that what we try and do, though, is we do try and set all these standards, these double standards, and we try and say, oh, but we can't have this institution. The thing is that very often you have an institution, but then the alternative is, OK, well, what do we replace it with? Because you have a look at the institution, say, for example, the President of the United States.
No, it's a different... This is the most dishonest argument.
Do you need to replace it?
A titular head of state is not the President of the United States. An elected head of... A ceremonial head of state. Yeah. I can think of three wonderful people we could elect.
Can I just say...
David Attenborough, Joanna Lumley... Trevor McDonald.
Oh, can bore
I, off. No, no, Yasmin.
Yeah. What
Yasmin,
a lot of rubbish.
Yasmin,
no,
Yasmin.
Can I mean, just, oh, for the love of God.
You think Charles has more charisma?
Can I just say, Yasmin.
It's not about charisma.
Yasmin, he has more charisma.
Yasmin, how did the transfer of power go in the last presidential election?
It's a different system. Do you
no,
not get
exactly.
That?
Because yes, the monarch...
We are talking about...
The monarch... The monarch ensures a peaceful transfer
rubbish.
Of power.
No.
The system
that's
is
what
the head of
a constitutional monarchy is.
I'm sorry.
Where do, no, no, no.
Sorry,
Marina, rubbish. Sorry. Can I finish my point here, please?
No, because you keep saying things that are... frankly, a little bit like
rubbish. No, because who like, do the politicians
but, sorry,
go to
me,
see after an election? Who do they go to see after an election?
You don't need to see the king to be able to move on to, because we've already elected them. You don't need a king or queen to do that.
The queen or king is a rubber stamp and nothing more.
Thank you.
But it still ensures the peaceful transfer of power. That is the
you're
system
made,
in
that's
our
what
country.
In
it's
Ireland.
Part of our Britain
in
constitution.
In Ireland, they have an elected president.
And look how that hurt. Look how that happened.
What do you
look
mean?
Look how that turned out.
What do you mean?
Look at all
are
the problems. Look at all the problems that are going on in Northern
no,
Ireland.
No, I'm talking about Ireland.
Ireland.
There are two countries.
Ireland.
Please,
Ireland.
I'm not talking about Northern Ireland.
I think
I'm talking about Ireland. Please inform yourself, Josh.
But I think
they have a president.
Yeah, but
they had Mary Robinson.
Yes,
they've had fantastic elected people who have then left their jobs and somebody else got elected.
Thank you.
Please.
I
know your facts.
I still don't see the point. The point you're trying to make about the position of the monarch is, I'm sorry, if anything, it proves that you don't need a monarch for that.
But I think,
okay? You don't
but
need
I think
a monarch
there
for
is,
that.
There are plenty of reasons, and I can understand why there are some people who dislike the idea of monarchy. They dislike the idea of being people being born into something. And there are a lot of things which are wrong with it on paper. But in practice, I think for this nation, it works pretty well, particularly internationally, when you are trying to get onto a world stage when we're a tiny little island. And I think that there are things which are very helpful. Now, you may...
Wait for Barbados.
That is so funny.
Barbados. Watch Barbados.
Yeah, and I'm sure... And if they decide that they don't want it, then fine. Don't want it. Don't have it.
A tiny little island has caused such havoc in this world. We're such a tiny little island. Look at us. We're just...
All
no. That is no reason to have a monarch. And if we're going to have the monarchy, then the monarchy should serve the people.
Well, they do.
No, they don't.
I think the
power that the monarchy in this country has, they use it for themselves, not for the rest of us.
I think that's an opinion.
That's not an opinion.
That's an opinion that I don't share.
If you have exemptions from things that I cannot be exempted from, that means you are taking care of yourself, not of me.
How do you both feel served by the royal family?
Because I feel that the monarchy as an institution upholds democracy in our
monarchy
country.
Monarchy and democracy don't even go hand in hand.
They are, because the monarch is at the head of a constitutional
monarchy.
Did you just
say constitutional? Oh, my God.
It.
What are you talking about?
We didn't elect them.
The whole point is they are...
Oh, my Lord.
You know, I'm not going to win. I'm not... You guys aren't going to let me finish any of my points, and I'm just not going to win.
OK.
We are not going to win.
Calm yourselves over there. So, look, sometimes in a society, having... whether it's continuity... Or people who are, I think we'd probably all agree that none of us would want the job either of a constitutional monarch or to be part of that family or to be part of that institution.
Exactly. Can you imagine sitting on my ass doing jack all except...
But you see, the thing is, though, that
they don't
do that. And the thing is that they do... It's actually the soft power that they wield that is very helpful, I think, to this nation. So, as somebody who is involved in various different charities, I know that when there is royal patronage, the ability to raise awareness, the ability to bring people on board... Attract attention, and also to raise money, and then also to further a good, if you like, in society. Because they are not politically elected... is in fact a great draw, and I think that's very helpful.
But that's not the reason why.
So but that is
James,
most of what they do. That's
James,
most of
James,
what they do.
Can I ask you? Do you think there's no charities in France, Germany, that people don't give to charity because they don't have a monarch? Second question: do you know? Because I did this research, the Queen never visited a food bank. Never went to a council estate where there was genuine poverty. I did my research. So please...
It would not have been appropriate, you know.
Please.
No, but I think that's just your inflection. You're never going.
I'm sorry. She just stated something.
Yes, but you're
Why
never.
Why did the Queen not attend or go to a food bank or go to a single, poverty-stricken council? How? If she's meant to be serving the people, and then, the recent one I saw was that King Charles donated fridges and freezers.
Yes.
To food bank. Can you imagine with everything he has, fridges and freezers, when he can wipe out, provide so much that there should be no food banks necessary in the whole world. What the hell?
I was watching a documentary the other day and they talked about how much of London is actually owned now by Qataris.
Mm. Yes.
And the Saudis. And then the follow-up line was, so much so they've now overtaken King Charles. And I thought, my goodness, he's got a lot of wealth, hasn't he? But I'm going to go around the table now, and here's a challenge for the panel. No interruptions. Let every single person speak their truth, as Meghan likes to do. Right, we're going to start with...
Josh is speaking.
We're going to start with Josh. There's no interruptions. We go around person to person. I've got a question for each of you.
OK.
Josh, would you abolish the monarchy, and why?
Absolutely not. I would not abolish the monarchy. I think, it's as James said, what they bring into charities, I think, is incredible. It's what, yes, you said, yeah, that of course there are going to be charities across the globe, but those charities do not benefit in other... Well, some might do, but, some might abroad might benefit from royal patronage, but the royals as an institution, the whole existence is to try and make the lives for people in this country better. That is what they're for.
Okay.
This is you said no interruptions.
Okay, I'm moving it on to James.
Okay, well, I wasn't allowed to finish my point, but okay.
We've only got so much time. We understand you think there's real value in the royal family, and we understand why. Okay. James.
I also think there's real value in the royal family. It doesn't mean that it's beyond reproach. It doesn't mean that we should look at it as something that can't be reformed. But as somebody who lives in this country, I think, as my grandfather used to say, in striving for better, oft we mar what's well. I.e., if you're going to come up with an alternative, then you've got to take the people with you. And I think if you had an election today, or if you had a poll, you would find that a majority would say that they would like to keep the constitutional monarchy. I don't think they'd want to keep it exactly the same, and I think you have to give King Charles an opportunity to put it out there and decide what he's going to do and how he's going to lead. And it's actually down to him to make sure that he has that support, because it's kind of consent. So I think that's really important. And let's not also overshadow, even if you disagree with the idea of monarchy, let's not overshadow the things that they do achieve, the attention that they are able to bring to charitable causes, to events, and also to step aside from the political wrangling, that we've all seen what happens when you have somebody who's politically elected. They can be elected on a minority, they can be really popular with a group of people, but then very divisive. I think the monarchy, if they are operating well and correctly, can bring us and the people together.
Okay.
Does it mean that they're faultless? No. Does it mean that we need more scrutiny? Yes. And does it mean that their behaviours in certain aspects need to be challenged? Absolutely.
Dr. Shola, would you abolish the monarchy?
In its present state, absolutely. I think that the monarchy presently symbolises what I would say are the very things that shape and divide this country. So whether it's racial inequality, class wars, when you look at the economic inequality and much more. And so I can't see how it reflects the best of this country when it embodies its worst. I would love to see some kind of referendum and see what people actually think or say, because I think the era of deference is gone. It definitely went with the death of the Queen. I think that the reality for us is that the monarchy today and yesterday, they don't serve the people. Whatever values you think they bring to the table is nil point compared to, I think, the worst that they bring and the irrelevance that they represent. That's what I think.
Yasmin.
I would abolish the system. I've always believed that you cannot be a democracy. The basic principle is this, that a child, however stupid, unworthy, whatever, born into that family, is automatically gifted a value that is higher than that of any other child, okay? So that's point number one. You cannot have a democracy where some people are born that much more, higher than others. The second thing is this particular family. When Diana died, even I, as a Republican, because she was so instinctively embracing of us, people of colour. I went to Kensington Gardens, and there was an astonishing Republican moment when she died. People were so angry with Charles, with Camilla, with the Queen even, who didn't turn up for a long time until the Queen, the people demanded that she come. Yeah. And those poor boys, these two boys, and I think Harry's been very damaged by that, forced to not to cry, to be... So there was a moment. That moment passed. The death of the Queen, and I agree with Max when he says...
James.
That's why I say Max.
It pained you to agree with me so much.
No, I agree with James when he says that the popularity with the Queen... The Jubilees, all the PR machine has been amazing. I'll give them that. It's very high. But I'll tell you that the correspondence I get, a lot of people hate Camilla. They have never forgotten Diana. And Charles has little charm. So we're in a new period.
In a new period. Can I ask a question, though? Because you just said something very
Normally
interesting.
Normally I'm supposed to ask
the question. I know, but I was just burning.
Okay.
So you said... You feel uncomfortable in a democracy about somebody being born into a position of privilege. But then before you'd said, but what about David Attenborough? David Attenborough would be no one if Richard Attenborough wasn't his father. David Beckham's children.
He didn't inherit the position.
No, but he was born into it. So how do you get over it? How do you reconcile the fact?
We have David Beckham instead.
So David Beckham and his children. How do you reconcile that
somebody... David Beckham wasn't born privileged.
No, he wasn't, but his children are in a position of being in a very privileged position as a result of that.
You are not giving them perpetual power.
I actually don't care about what family you're born into, because I think ultimately your character... whatever it is that you experience in life shapes who you are, and the output you put out in the world would then be determined by that. That does not bother me. I am bothered by the institution. I'm bothered by the fact that, you know, as far as I'm concerned, this institution, there's a royal family. I think they abuse their power. I don't think that they're held to account. I think that this
What's
whole
the
deference...
Press for?
Sorry?
What's the press?
What's the press for? You What's tell me. Because
the press holds power to account.
Oh, no, no, they don't. Not in this blessed country. Some of them do, but majority of them definitely kiss up to the, you know what, of the royal family.
So all the criticism that in the past that Charles has got, that Diana got, that Camilla got, that William, that Catherine, that Meghan, that Harry, the Queen, Her Majesty the Queen, Prince William, all the criticism that they've got, what do you think that is from?
That is not necessarily, and let me finish this, when we talk about the Queen, I hardly saw the Queen being held to account, except for instance, when Diana passed. And that was because people were losing their minds at what the hell do you think you're doing? Every other royal, except those that the royal family themselves are briefed against, they've all been protected. I mean, look at Camilla, for instance. Since she got married to Charles, I have not seen negative press about her.
And why would you?
What?
Because she's actually a very charming lady.
Oh my God! Oh my God! Oh my
goodness!
She's actually a charming woman.
Domestic violence, which we saw the reception being held in the first place.
Okay, Josh, I heard her say at this event, make a very moving speech, that the voices of victims need to be heard. Diana was emotionally abused, and she destroyed Diana's life. Mm-hmm. Her voice was not heard in the royal family. Meghan received no support. Her voice was not heard.
If Camilla is so lovely, explain to me how Camilla can be instrumental, one, in what she did to Harry's mother, Diana, and now to Harry's wife, by having someone like Angela Levin be her biographer. But she's so lovely. She's such a lovely woman.
Do you know Angela Levin?
Yes,
Because I do know Angela, and
so
she is a lovely lady.
Oh, my God.
I'm
going
to stop there, Josh. Because actually, Josh, what you might see on the surface sometimes with people, I meet lots of people in this work, and they can be absolutely lovely to your face, but if they hold back...
Are you denying my conversations with Angela now?
I'm saying just because she's lovely to you doesn't mean she's lovely to
everybody else.
Right, last question, and we're going to try, please, to keep it calm. I feel like I need
Angela
to...
Angela just went, oh, look how white Meghan's skin look. She tweeted that. How lovely is she?
What do we think this documentary, Meghan and Harry, will do to the continuation of the royal family. Now, it's not what you want to happen. What do you think will happen, Josh?
The answer to that is I don't know. I don't know. It depends what is being said in the documentary. All that I do know is that they want to, yes, they want to tell their stories, but we're all expecting, we're all bracing ourselves for bombshells in this documentary. That is what we do know. But all that I will say to everyone's points around the table, and this is something that I haven't said, because you talked about the racist press, and I know you guys haven't necessarily said it around this table, but a lot of people online have accused a lot of people who criticise Meghan Markle and Prince Harry as misogynistic for their criticism of Prince Harry, of Meghan Markle. Now, I want to ask a question, and that is, you know, for a lot of us Meghan and Harry critics, per se, you know, we criticise Prince Harry the same, if not more so, than Meghan Markle. You know, we criticise them for a couple for their actions, not because of anything else. And that's because they want to go out and do as much damage to an institution that you guys might not necessarily feel passionate about, but a lot of us do feel passionate about this institution. A lot of us do feel served by this institution. A lot of us see the good work that they do for average Brits day in, day out. A lot of the people think, a lot of the people see what they do for charities. And that, I think, is a good thing.
James. That was very passionate.
James. What do you think is going to happen?
I think, look, inevitably there is going to be a lot of fallout. There is no doubt that this will contain a range of bombshells. We may learn some things. We may be shocked by some of the things. I think the royal institution and household, if it doesn't change, adapt, up its game in a number of areas, I think we're going to see people perhaps being a little bit more hostile to them, because in the same way that we gave the Queen a lot of grace because she had always been the Queen, Charles is new on the throne and I think he is going to have to earn it far more. So that means that William in particular is really going to have to up his game in terms of what he does, how hard they work, and the things that they can demonstrably show to people that this is who the new monarchy is. Because regardless of what one says about it and the fact that whether if you think it's wrong or that they shouldn't be doing it and all that stuff, it is out there. The book is coming out. There is no way that Netflix are going to produce something, we've already seen it, that isn't going to shock the institution to its core. And that means that the institution is going to have to change and reinvent or die.
Well, surprise, surprise, I agree with Josh when he says, I don't know. I don't know when it comes to the continuity of the royal family. I don't know. I agree with James when he says that, you know, this may, you know, bring people to be more hostile to the royal family if they don't up their game totally. But let me also add this, that if there are bombshells out there, what it means is that it's going to pose a significant reputational risk. Now, do I think the royal family is going to collapse and die because of this documentary? No. I think it's going to chip at their legitimacy and credibility, as many other things have been doing. But what definitely would harm them is if reputationally they keep going down and they do not do the needful. I mean, look at earlier this year, with William and Kate going on their 70th Jubilee tour, and look at how they were received. Nobody was thinking, oh, yes, we see the Queen as somebody, as a head of state of this country, and she's done so much for our people. I mean, these people are not blind. She did jack all for them. Absolutely nada. And this is where people throw it. But the Commonwealth, she did nothing for the Commonwealth. The Commonwealth is nothing but a replica of British Empire. But anyway, let me put that to one side. The bottom line is, I don't think the royal family is going to now die because of the scandal. I do think that reputationally, it could be scandalous. Mm. I've got my popcorn ready. Let's go!
Yasmin.
I don't think it'll damage the royal family. What it will do, because the press and people on the opposite side of the table will carry on defending them and attacking Meghan. And my fear is that now that we... Can I... Look, I didn't interrupt you
two. No, you didn't.
So why are you doing it now? Please. That the press and people like this and the media, you know, the right-wing media is going to absolutely go again for Meghan. And we heard from Neil Basu last week, who was one of the top guys at the Met, that she actually faced real threats of violence, and there were some secret prosecutions. So my fear is for Harry and Meghan, not for this lot. They will survive. Their PR machine is second to none.
I just want to very quickly say they won't go after Meghan like how you say they will, because it's both of them. They're both accountable for their actions. Harry is just to blame, if not more so, than Meghan. It's not.
No.
It's Meghan both of them.
It's Meghan who gets it, and Harry is attacked as...
Harry is attacked as
the weak husband who is led by the nose. Angela Lennon has alluded to that many times, that Harry is simply just following whatever his wife does.
No, that's not true. I believe that Prince Harry has a lot of pent-up trauma from what happened when he was younger.
I think he has
a long-standing resentment against the royal family. And I believe that he is just to blame, if not more so, for everything that's going on.
As far as I know.
I'll say it again. Prince Harry is the husband to Meghan that Prince Charles never was to Diana. And as far as I'm concerned, that's the kind of character we want to see.
And let me tell you this, as far as we know, there have not been the level of threats, physical threats, to Harry as there have been to Meghan. Mm-hmm. That is true. And therefore, I really fear for her.
Mm.
Okay, right. Do you know what I think the outcome of this is going to be? Okay. I think Prince Andrew is going to be chilling. He's going to be like, the spotlight is off me. I'm going to just get
He's going to wish he could get back into the institution.
You know,
we could probably agree in something.
Yes.
I don't ever wish to see Prince Andrew in any official capacity.
Agreed.
Ever.
Do we agree?
And I would 100% agree with
that. Oh, look at that!
Close on that, because that is all that we have time for tonight. Thank you so much for joining us. It's been a great conversation / argument. But let us know what you think in the comments. Did anyone change your mind? Did anyone leave you outraged? There was quite a lot of outrage on the table tonight. Let us know on Twitter. And if you want to support Byline TV, you can by becoming a member at byline.tv/join and using the code MARINA, M-A-R-I-N-A, all capitals, to get your first month for just £2. What a bargain. See you next time. Good night.